On this week's show, the world reacts to the Tesla Model 3, BYD claims it has the best electric vehicles in the world, and a crowd-funded hydrogen fuel cell car. No, really. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories we're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolve.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, April 8th, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and as always, this show is brought to you by the wonderful people who support Transport Evolved with a monthly donation through Patreon. It's thanks to them that we're able to do this show, and I speak for the whole Transport Evolved team when I tell you that you are really, truly awesome for digging deep every month. Thank you. Before I start today's show, I think it's worth noting that it really would have been easy to spend the entire show talking about the Tesla Model 3 this week. With more than 320,000 pre-order reservations thus far, the Tesla Model 3 has been in the news a lot this week, with good reason. But while we've done our fair share of Model 3 stories, we also know there's been a lot else going on this week worth covering. That said, we're going to start with Tesla for our first story, namely reactions to the Tesla Model 3 from Nissan and General Motors, both of whom plan to bring their own long-range electric cars to market in the next few years. Nissan first. Speaking at an event in Japan this week to commemorate those who lost their lives at Nissan's various production facilities as a consequence of the 2011 tsunami and earthquake, Renault Nissan CEO Carlos Ghosn, who has spearheaded both companies' electric vehicle programs for nearly a decade, welcomed the Model 3 and its massive reservation list. "Finally, some good competition for EVs," he said, stating emphatically that the Tesla Model 3 will be good for both Tesla and the rest of the electric auto industry, and reinforcing his belief that Tesla is an ally, not a rival. Over at General Motors, things are a little less friendly, and as we explained on Wednesday, while GM seems to share Nissan's belief that Tesla's success will be good for everyone, a GM spokesperson couldn't resist a dig at Tesla's waiting list for the Model 3, snidely noting that GM won't have a waiting list for the 2017 Bolt EV, a 200-plus-mile electric car that goes on sale later this year at a price of around $37,500. Instead, they said, GM will launch the thing and customers won't find themselves waiting for years to get their car. In a world where we'd hope all automakers work together to bring EVs to market, we've got to say that we're a little more than a little disappointed in the Detroit automaker, and from the comments left on our site this week, you are too. Talking of disappointment, there was a little cloud on Tesla's otherwise unblemished blue sky this week when the California company released its Q1 2016 delivery figures, showing a slight deficit between its target figure and the actual number of cars delivered. Managing 14,820 cars in total, split between 12,420 Model S and 2,400 Model X, Tesla said that it had missed its 16,000 vehicle target for the quarter due to a parts shortage for Model X. That shortage, it said by definition, was caused in part by its own hubris and perhaps a little too much focus on cramming the Model X full of cutting-edge technology that's never been used before. Then again, when you've netted more than $350 million in deposits for your next-generation electric car, one which won't even enter production until next year, we don't think Tesla should be too sad. Although we should note that those 350,000 reservations do not mean sales. Tesla won't be able to claim that until all of those orders have been confirmed, despite what it says so far. Yes, I just said it. We're heading back to Nissan now and its troublesome Nissan Connect EV telematics system next, because this week Nissan quietly rolled out an update which made it possible to once again check on the status of your Nissan Leaf or Nissan EnV200 electric cars from your smartphone. That is assuming that you don't own the entry-level S trim, or Vizia in Europe. The update, rolled out via the Apple and Android app stores this week, brings back remote climate control and charging activation, as well as remote route planning and state of charge inquiry. But as we're already learning, the app isn't working for everyone, with some owners finding they need to get Nissan to reset their car's connection before things start working. And if you happen to live in places like Australia and New Zealand, well, we're hearing that there's no update planned for either market, which frankly isn't good form, Nissan. Not cool, not cool at all. What is cool, however, is the news from the US Department of Energy's Oak Ridge National Laboratory this week that it successfully completed testing of a wireless inductive charging system for electric cars. The system can not only transfer power at up to 20 kilowatts with an impressive 90% efficiency, but it can also do so while the car is in motion, opening a door for a future where cars can wirelessly charge while just driving down the road. At this point, I should note that the achievements from the ORNL aren't that impressive when taken one by one, but combining them all in a single system is. Using high-power, carefully focused magnetic fields, the research team say its 20 kilowatt inductive charging system is safe for all and won't expose any person or living thing to dangerous levels of EM radiation. And as someone who has an implanted device and has to give the X-ray machines at the airport a wide berth, I'm very pleased to hear that. Why is 20 kilowatts so important? Well, it's about the maximum power an electric car needs to move itself along at high speed on a reasonably flat road. And that means if we can get an inductive charging lane installed on high-speed roads, electric car owners could theoretically drive unlimited miles, assuming that is, they stay in the said inductive lane. Moving forward, ORNL's researchers say they're going to start work on a more powerful 50 kilowatt system. And that could not only provide power to move you along, but divert unused power from the transfer right into the battery pack. And it's all very clever. From one government-funded agency to another now, in the form of the EPA, which admitted this week that it might not reach a satisfactory agreement with German automaker Volkswagen over the ongoing Dieselgate scandal in time for the April 21st deadline set it by a US federal district court. As we explained earlier this week, the deadline was given to Volkswagen last month as part of a planned court proceedings against it for selling cars with devices specifically designed to cheat in emissions tests, emitting up to 40 times the legal NOx levels permitted under US law at all other times. Alongside the $46 billion and rising fines it must pay to the US Department of Justice for violating those laws, Volkswagen must come up with a plan for how it will ensure non-compliant cars, more than 580,000 on the roads of the US alone, before April 21st. It must also get those plans approved by the US EPA and the California Air Resources Board. But with just over 2 weeks left, the pressure is on, so we'll be keeping a close eye on this emissions scandal to see just what happens next. Changing gears now, we're off to Brazil, where Chinese company BYD has published a new video this week talking at length about BYD Brazil and its lineup of internal combustion and plug-in vehicles. The video itself is somewhere between a corporate promotional video and traditional advert, and it goes to great lengths to show the various tests that BYD electric vehicles must go through before its cars can be brought to market. Proudly listing one test after another, BYD manages to make it sound as if its cars are tested in ways that other vehicles from rival companies are not. The problem is that they are. Every automaker we know puts its cars through as an exhaustive a process. Regardless of this fact, BYD says its attention to detail means its cars, specifically its electric ones, are the highest quality vehicles in the world. Belief in one's product is one thing, but if my experience several years ago behind the wheel of an early production BYD E6 is anything to go by, for that statement to be true, I must be the world's toughest automotive journalist. Like, a kabillion times more jaded than Jeremy Clarkson. And I just don't think I am. Am I? Regardless of the answer to that one, I can tell you, however, that the transition from fossil fuels to electric drivetrains will transform the automotive industry forever and completely reinvent the car. At least, that's according to Jaguar's design chief, who told British magazine Autocar this week that the switch to electric vehicles will result in more changes to the humble automobile in the next 15 years than has occurred in the past 100. Referencing the way in which electric drivetrain technology can reclaim massive amounts of space under the hood, Jaguar's Ian Callum said that the future cars could be smaller on the outside than today's models without compromising interior volume, making them more efficient and requiring less parking space than today's gas-guzzling models. And of course, with Jaguar's upcoming adventure in Formula E, we're bound to see more examples of electric vehicles from the luxury British brand. Talking at length, Callum enthused that switching to electric presented more opportunities for automakers than any of the associated setbacks, meaning that electric car technology is good for everyone. It's something that we've been saying for a bloody long time now, so we're glad that Jaguar is finally getting with the program. If a little late. But not too late to the world of electric cars is Nissan, which, as you probably know, has been making plug-in cars you can buy since late 2010. So far, those cars have been utilitarian everyday hatchbacks in the form of the Nissan Leaf, and the mid-size electric minivans in the form of the EN V200. But on Thursday this week, Nissan's senior president, Shiro Nakamura, confirmed that the Japanese automaker was in the process of developing a modular platform which could one day give rise to a range of all-electric and conventionally powered vehicles. Of those, one could conceivably be an all-electric sports car or crossover, he hinted. To date, Nissan has been adamant that it wants to focus on large-volume mainstream cars, which does suggest that an all-electric crossover based on this new unnamed platform would be more likely than a sports car. But there's also a possibility that the platform could make something like the Nissan S-Flow, a concept car we saw back in early 2011, a commercial reality. Sadly, however, Nissan isn't sharing any more information on this one, so we'll have to wait until it confirms such a model before we get too excited. And finally, it looks like a cross between an early Honda Insight hybrid and the EV1 is made in Wales and claims an impressive overall efficiency. And it weighs less than a Smart for two-seat microcar. And this week, we learned that Riversimple, the company behind the two-seat hydrogen-powered Riversimple Risa Coupe, is turning to crowdfunding as a way of raising the money it needs to bring its unusual and quirky lightweight hydrogen fuel cell car to market. To supplement its $2.27 million grant from the European Union and a six-figure investment from various British investors, Riversimple is offering individuals the chance to own a proportion of the company in exchange for raising an additional £1 million sterling in capital. While there doesn't seem to be any minimum figure that we can see for anyone putting down money, anyone putting down £100,000 or more will be offered one of three beta cars after testing is finished and will be granted exclusive use for as long as they want. But be careful. At the moment, Riversimple doesn't have the network required to provide support all over the UK, let alone worldwide. I'm not able to provide you with much support either, but I am able to tell you that I'll be back next week at the usual time with another episode of T.E.N. In the meantime, you'll find all the news that's fit to print at our website at transportevolve.com. You can catch up with us on Twitter at transportevolve, or you can check out our latest shows on YouTube. And if you liked what you saw today, please consider keeping us independent and impartial by visiting our Patreon page at patreon.com/transportevolve and pledging your support from as little as $1 per month. As I've said before, we are 100% funded by our readers and we have zero ads on our site. So if you can, we'd really love you to help us by showing your appreciation through Patreon. We are still away from our next target, but once we reach it, we will be able to dramatically increase our content for you all to enjoy, and that's good for everyone. Talking of content, there's a lot we haven't managed to fit into today's show, including the five things we like best about the Tesla Model 3 electric car, based on what we know thus far, the five things we don't like about the same car, with the same disclaimer, how the Tesla Model 3 and Trabant are more similar than you might think, with a smile on our face, and we find out why Ford has planned the Model 3 name it threatened Tesla with court action to come to market in about a year's time. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a great weekend, and until next time, keep evolving.